So today let's take a look at the switching power supply which comes from a DVD player. I don't have the DVD player anymore, but I have taken this board out of it and I'm going to show it to you. The board contains a complete switching power supply with about 3 output voltages, and the most interesting part about it is that it has no switching transistor. As you can see on the primary side, there is just no power transistor. There is just this 8-pin chip. The transistor is actually integrated in the chip, as well as most of the components necessary for a switching power supply, which makes it quite simple. And there's really not so many components in it, and the mains comes in this connector. There is a fuse, a bridge rectifier made of discrete diodes, some smoothing capacitors, and a filter inductor. There is some small capacitor in parallel to the power of the chip, some resistors, a small capacitor, and a diode. This is probably the snubber network. And there is another diode, probably rectifying the power for the chip from the auxiliary winding of the transformer. There is some capacitor for stability. Here is the optocoupler, some safety interference capacitor, the switching transformer with a ferrite core, and there are some capacitors at the output with some rectifying diodes. There's another diode. Here's the output. Some loading resistors, so the power supply never runs with no load. And there is the voltage feedback with a voltage reference, probably 431, and some resistors making a resistive divider for it to set the voltage. And some capacitor for stability. And that's more or less it. And there is another inductor to improve the filtering of the output voltage. And that's about it. There are no SMD components in it. It's just purely through-hole technology. There seems to be some components omitted in it. There is some interference capacitor omitted. The NTC thermistor to limit the inrush is also omitted here. And some interference inductor is omitted here. There are also some omitted components on the secondary side. Some other connectors, some resistors, probably some regulators, some other capacitors, transistors. As you can see, there's a huge isolation distance on the board between the primary and the secondary side, so it looks quite safe. There's an interference suppression capacitor on the board between the primary and the secondary side, but this one is a safety class Y1 capacitor, so it also should be safe. Now the question is, what are the output voltages? Let's try to remove this one. And you can see a marking on the board. It says minus 12. Plus 12, plus 5. So it has 3 output voltages, minus 12 volts, plus 12 volts, and plus 5 volts. The minus 12 volt and plus 12 volt outputs have just tiny filtering capacitors, so the maximum current is probably just very low. And there is plus 5 volt output, which has 2 bigger capacitors. It has one capacitor, a filter inductor, and another capacitor for better filtering. And the diode of the 5-volt power supply is bigger than the other ones. So the 5-volt output is apparently the most powerful one. I don't like that some components are omitted here, like this inductor and this capacitor for interference suppression and this NTC thermistor for inrush current limiting, but otherwise it looks like a nice switching power supply. Now let's try to reverse engineer it. So here you can see the schematic of it, which is not very complicated because the chip does almost everything. Especially the primary side is very simple thanks to the chip. The secondary side is a bit more complex because it has 3 different output voltages. So the mains comes in, there is a fuse, the NTC thermistor is omitted unfortunately, there is a bridge rectifier made of discrete diodes, the first smoothing capacitor, an interference inductor and another capacitor. Here you can see the chip, the primary of the transformer, the startup resistor, the snubber network, the auxiliary winding with a rectifier and a capacitor. Here is the optocoupler in the feedback circuitry. This is the interference capacitor, which is a safety type. And on the secondary side, there are secondary windings, some rectifying diodes, capacitors, a filter inductor for better filtering on this rail, some loading resistor here, and the voltage feedback with some resistive divider, the voltage reference, some capacitor for stability, and this resistor is in series with the LED in the optocoupler, and some resistor in parallel. And this one is making plus and minus 12 volts. There are the capacitors, and there is some strange. Is it a resistive divider to reduce the voltage a little bit, or is this one a loading resistor and this one is a current limiting resistor? I don't know. I don't know the original purpose of this in the DVD player. The operation is quite simple. When you turn it on, the chip has to start it up. It will use this resistor and this input to charge this capacitor and it will start running. And then when it's running, it actually uses this auxiliary winding to charge this capacitor and generate a power for it. And this one is actually used just for the startup, because if you were dropping the voltage from 300 volts down to, let's say, 12 volts, it would dissipate a lot of power, so this is just for a short moment when it starts up, and then it generates the power for the chip using this winding and this rectifying diode. There is a snubber network protecting the chip against high voltage peaks from the primary, because when the switch in the chip turns off, it will generate a high voltage peak, and this one is actually clamped by this circuitry. It will rectify the impulse into this capacitor and dissipate it in those resistors. Now let's take a look at the voltage regulation. There is a feedback circuitry with a resistive divider, and the resistors are chosen such a way that when it reaches the proper voltage, the resistive divider gives 2.5 volts, because this voltage reference actually turns on at 2.5 volts. Now when it turns on, it will supply a current into this LED in the optocoupler. It will light up and illuminate this phototransistor, which turns on and it pulls down the feedback pin. When this input is pulled down, the chip will limit the duty cycle, or the portion of time when it's on. So the power going into the transformer will be lower and the output voltage goes no longer up. It just keeps it at the proper voltage. There are more outputs, and the voltage sensing is connected to this one, which means that this one is going to be regulated quite accurately, and those ones are going to be regulated just roughly. The voltage of this one is regulated, and the voltage of those ones depends on the number of turns in the transformer. So I don't know the numbers, but let's give an example. If this one has 10 turns, it will be about 2 turns per volt. So to get 12 volts here, those ones have to have about 24 turns, because it's still 2 turns per volt. Now, according to the ratio of the turns, it's going to be about roughly 12 volts. But because the coupling between the windings is not perfect, it's going to be just roughly. So this is to give you an idea how a switching power supply works when it has more outputs. There is usually one output which has the voltage sensing on it, and the voltage is quite accurate, and the other ones are just roughly regulated, because the voltage depends on the number of turns. The numbers of turns are just an example, it can be different, but at a given moment, the voltage per turn is the same in all of the windings. And if the chip requires, let's say, 10 volts for its operation, here, the auxiliary winding has to have, let's say, 20 turns. Because it's still 2 turns per volt in this example. Now let's also put the primary into the calculation, but be prepared that now it's going to be really complicated. Because first I have to explain that this is a flyback switching power supply, which means that when the chip or the transistor in it is on, the diodes are in reverse, and when the transistor or chip is off, the diodes are conducting a current. So the power is not going directly from the primary into the secondary. In one step, the energy goes into the primary and is being stored in the core of the transformer as a magnetic field. And in the second step, the energy from the core goes into the secondary and into the capacitors via the diodes. The chip is working as a switching transistor here, so it's the same as if you had a discrete transistor here. It's basically switching the output to the common rail here, to 0 volts. Now let's imagine it's running off 220 volt mains. The rectification will actually increase the voltage by the square root of 2, or about 1.414. So the voltage at those capacitors will be 220 times 1.414, which is, let's say, roughly about 300 volts. Now let's begin with the situation when the transistor is on. So it will connect this voltage to the primary of the transformer. It will connect it in this polarity. Now some voltage will also appear on the other windings, and its polarity will depend on the direction of the winding, which is usually marked using those dots in the schematic. So now the dot is negative, so the other dots will be also negative, and the other end with no dot is positive, so those will also be positive. Now let's take a look at the secondaries and the auxiliary winding. And you can notice that all the diodes are now in reverse. So there is some energy going into the primary of the transformer, but there is no energy going out. So the energy is actually being stored in the core of the transformer. Now, when the transistor is on, the current goes up as the energy builds up in the core of the transformer. And the current disappears as the transistor turns off. Now, when the transistor turns off, the polarity will swap. So now the polarity is like this on the primary, and so the dots are all positive. So the polarity is like this here, it's like this here, like this, and like this. Now, because the transistor is off, there is no energy going into the transformer. But those diodes are all in forward, they're conductive now, and the energy that has been stored in the core of the transformer goes out from the secondaries via the diodes into the capacitors. So now it's charging those all capacitors. And the energy goes out from the transformer core. Now the voltage on the primary has such polarity that it's adding to this voltage. So the voltage stress on this transistor is actually more than just this voltage. The voltage here is adding to the voltage of the rectified mains. So the voltage on this transistor is actually more than just 300 volts. Now this example is missing the number of turns of the primary. So let's say it's 200 turns. Because it's a nice number, and I have actually seen transformers where the primary really was 200 turns, so it's not so far from reality. Now it's going to get even more complicated, because this is the point where I have to explain you that the voltage of the winding can be different in each polarity. It's getting more and more complex, but switching power supplies are just not simple. So the winding can have a different voltage in each polarity. So there is a voltage in one polarity, and then the polarity swaps, and the voltage is not the same. Now it's going to be very messy, so be prepared for it. So, when the transistor is on, it's going to be green. And in the situation when it's off, it's going to be purple. So now it's on. It's connecting 300 volts to the primary, which has 200 turns. So it's 1.5 volts per turn, which is the same as 0.66 turns per volt. So we have 1.5 volts per turn, which means that this winding is going to have 36 volts. This one as well. This one is going to be 15 volts. And this one is going to be 30 volts. As you can see, the voltage is much higher than the voltage at the output. But it's not a problem because it's in the other polarity, where the diode is in reverse. So the voltage doesn't go to the output. Now it's in the green polarity and the diodes are not conducting. Now the transistor turns off, the polarity will swap and the energy from the transformer has to go somewhere and it will go into the outputs. So now it's in the purple polarity and the voltages are given by the voltages at the outputs. So here it's 12 volts, here it's 5 volts and 10 volts. Now the question is, what is the voltage on the primary? So in the purple polarity it is 24 turns, 12 volts, or 10 turns, 5 volts, which means it is about 0.5 volts per turn, which is the same as 2 turns per volt. But to prevent a confusion, let's just use volts per turn as our unit. So now there is 0.5 volts per turn. So the primary is going to have 100 volts in the purple polarity. So as you can see, each winding can have two different voltages according to the polarity of the voltage on it. In our example, the voltage is 1.5 volts per turn in one polarity and 0.5 volts per turn in the other polarity. So when the transistor is on, it will connect the rectified mains to the primary and so the primary voltage will be, let's say 300 volts. Let's give it a minus. And when it turns off, it's going to be 100 volts in the other polarity. Like this. So the voltages are different in each polarity, but it's compensated by the fact that each polarity happens for a different amount of time. In this polarity, the voltage is 3 times higher, so the time will be 3 times shorter. So in this example, it's going to be 25% of time and 75% of time. It has to be like this because the average DC voltage is always zero. It basically cancels out. There is always a zero DC voltage on an inductor or transformer. The negative and positive half cycle has to cancel out. So if one has a higher voltage, the other one has to have a longer time. So as you can see, the voltage doesn't have to be the same in each polarity, which is important for a flyback switching power supply because the output voltage has to be still the same, but the input voltage is changing. You can have a wide range switching power supply which can run from 100 volts to 240 volts and the output voltage is still the same. And also the mains is not very accurate, so the voltage is changing. You can also have an adjustable switching power supply where you are changing the output voltage without changing the input voltage. Now the transistor is on for 25% of time, so the duty cycle is 25%. Now let's imagine the rectified mains is just 200 volts. So the negative half cycle is minus 200 volts, but the positive one will still be 100 volts. Like this. This is because the chip will increase the duty cycle to compensate for the lower voltage. So in this example it will be 33% duty cycle on. So the transistor is on for 33% of time. And the rest of it is about 66%. So now it runs with a higher duty cycle, 33%. Now this half cycle has 2 times the voltage, so the other one has to have 2 times the time. So if the input voltage changes, the chip changes the duty cycle to compensate it. Now it's already a bloody mess, but let's take a look at the voltage on the semiconductors. It's important because you have to choose semiconductors with a proper rating. Now let's take a look at this diode. There is 12 volts on this capacitor all the time, but when this winding is in the other polarity, the voltage of it is adding to it. So there is 12 volts on the capacitor plus 36 volts on the inductor. So the total voltage on this diode is 48 volts. So the voltages on the semiconductors are going to be gray in rectangles. So this one has 48 volts. And this one is also going to have 48 volts on it. And this one is 5 plus 15. So it's 20 volts on it. And this one is 30 plus 10. It is 40 volts on it. And finally the transistor is 300 plus 100, so it's 400 volts for the transistor. But of course, in reality, you have to calculate what is the worst case. The mains in the world is always from 100 to 240 volts, and it is usually plus minus 10%. So the worst case is 240 volts plus the 10% error, which is 24 volts, so you can have up to 264 volts in the mains. So in the worst case, the mains is 264 volts times the square root of 2, which is about 1.414, and you get about 373 volts. So let's round it to 380, which is the worst voltage or highest voltage you can get after the rectification. Plus 100 in the other polarity, so in the worst case the transistor is going to see 480 volts. So finally you can use a 500 volt transistor, which doesn't have much headroom, so it's going to be a little dodgy, or you can use a 600 volt transistor to make it reliable. And I also have to say that I didn't calculate with the voltage drop of those diodes to make it simple. And the voltage of this diode will be 380 volts on the primary divided by 200 turns of the primary winding times the amount of turns of this winding, 24, and it is 45 volts plus 12 volts in the other polarity, which is 57.6 volts. So I can use a 60 volt diode, which is going to be dodgy, or a 75 or 80 volt diode to make it reliable. So this diode is rated about 80 volts. Oh, bloody hell, there is a sticky tape on it. 80 volts to make it reliable. Let's take a look at this diode. It's going to be 380 divided by 200 turns times 10 turns. So it's 19 volts in the worst case, plus the 5 volts in the other polarity. So it's 24 volts in the worst case. So you can use a 30 or 40 volt diode, which can easily be a Schottky diode, which has a lower voltage drop and it's very fast. And those diodes are going to be either ultra-fast or Schottky. I also have to say that those waveforms I have drawn are quite simplified, and in reality it can be more complicated. The most important is that it can have some overshoot or ringing or oscillation. So the voltage when the transistor turns off can overshoot like this. Or it can be ringing like this. And this is actually adding to the voltage of the transistor, so it makes the voltage on it higher. And so there is a snubber network to get rid of it. The snubber network can clamp it down like this. With the snubber network, the voltage doesn't overshoot so much on the transistor here. When the transistor turns off, Most of the energy from the core goes into the secondaries, but because the coupling between the windings is not perfect, some small portion of the energy goes back into the primary. And the snubber network is here to absorb it. I was showing the current of the primary, and now let's take a look at the current on the secondary. When the transistor is off, the energy from the transformer goes into the secondaries. As the energy comes out of the transformer, the secondary current goes down. Like this. So the current goes up as the energy builds up in the core of the transformer, and the current goes down as the energy leaves the core of the transformer. And of course, in this example, the transistor is built into the chip, it's integrated in it, but the same applies to a switching power supply with a discrete transistor. A lot of people are asking me about how to change the output voltage of a switching power supply. Of course, you can do it by changing those resistors in the resistive divider. So by changing one of those two resistors, you can change the output voltage, but there is a lot of considerations. By changing the voltage on this output, you also change the voltage of the other outputs, if the power supply has more outputs. But you also change the voltage of the auxiliary power supply, so the voltage can get too low or too high for the chip. If you increase the voltage at the output, you also increase the voltage on the primary. So the voltage of the transistor is also getting higher. By increasing the output voltage, you also increase the voltage on all of those output capacitors and all of those output diodes. So it's not a problem to change the voltage a little bit, let's say from 5 volts up to 6 volts or down to, let's say, 4 volts. If you change it down too much, the biggest problem is that this chip is not going to get enough voltage for its operation. And if you increase it significantly, there is even more problems. Now let's make an example, and I'm running out of colors, so let's use a very thick black pen as a last resort, because now it's completely messed up already. So let's try to increase the output voltage here to 10 volts. So now all the voltages are going to double. This one is going to be 24 and minus 24 and this one for the chip is going to be 20 volts, which may easily destroy it because it's supposed to have 10 volts. And the voltage on the primary was 100 volts. Now it becomes 200. Which can also destroy the transistor in it. So before increasing the voltage, you have to make sure that the transistor is rated enough, or change it for a transistor with a higher voltage rating. You also have to check the rating of the diodes and the capacitors at the output, or the other ones if there are more outputs. You can replace them if they are not rated enough, but if you change the voltage significantly, the voltage for the chip may not be right. So it may be necessary to add a small power supply for the chip. So you may have to disconnect it here and connect another power supply for the chip, like this, with an external power supply. The voltage of the chip is independent of the output voltages. The most simple solution is to completely disconnect the auxiliary winding and to drop the voltage from the power rail using a power resistor like this and regulated using some zener diode like this. In some designs, the resistor comes from the AC voltage via another diode to dissipate less power, because now it's dropping from 220 volts instead of 300 volts. So the resistor can go from here instead of here. You can also make it an adjustable power supply by adding a potentiometer into the resistive divider. The potentiometer can be in series with the lower resistor or with the upper resistor, like this or like this. And if you increase the voltage, you have to reduce the current, so the power is not higher than the original one. And it's also possible to move this current sensing circuitry to another output if you need it. And you can also remove some of the outputs or disable them by cutting it here or by disconnecting those diodes. So this is probably all about how does a flyback switching power supply work and how can you modify it. And I wanted to show this one in operation and do some measurements, but this video is probably getting very long, so let's put it into another video. So this is Diagonal Wild and see you in my next videos.